faithwire.com. Well, hello, and welcome to 4 and 3, the podcast to get your day going. Four of the most important stories and three things you need to know about them. Today's Friday, January 8th, 2021. I'm Dan Andros. Coming up, we've got four stories. Capitol Police officer has died. We'll have the details on that. The president and social media, will he be banned for life? Why Christians need to be praying for Nigeria and calls for the 25th Amendment. Will it actually happen? Joining me to break it all down, Trey Gons Phillips. Trey, what's going on?
Hey, happy Friday, Dan. It's just this week has been a doozy.
It has been, I mean, one thing after another. I didn't even know the Capitol Police officer was injured, let alone had died. Now, I did see all the footage of them running people over, so not surprised by this news, but I did not hear about the injuries suffered. Apparently, he was on life support, and they pulled that last night. So that is where we are going to start. Get the details on that, on who the officer is right now for you. Brian Sicknick was a Trump-supporting U.S. Capitol Police officer and military veteran. He died of injuries suffered during the riots at Capitol Hill on the 6th. At the Capitol building, authorities say Sicknick was injured while, quote, physically engaging with rioters. The U.S. Capitol Police Department said in a statement he died at 9:30 last night. Well, what is the left saying? Well, both the left and right are offering condolences for this officer. Beyond that, it's pretty much been left at that. Some on the right are claiming the left is being a little disingenuous because of how they berated officers all summer long and called for the abolishing of police, saying it kind of rings a little hollow there from that perspective. But mainly people are just offering their condolences. So why does it matter? It matters because violence, like we saw yesterday, clearly is wrong. It was wrong over the summer when Antifa and BLM were overrunning police barricades, assaulting officers with fireworks and everything else. Some officers were killed while they were responding to these riots. It happened in St. Louis. It happened elsewhere. And so it was wrong then. And it's wrong today. I mean, the scenes we saw Wednesday were remarkably similar to those we saw over the summer. You got people running over barricades, disregard, yelling at the officers, etc.
Yeah.
And that bears no resemblance to anything remotely pertaining to Christianity. It reveals more of desperation, aggression, disregard for fellow man. And so if you can't condemn both, you honestly think you have to question your motives and ask yourself, are you just a political hack? Are you defending a position? And is that position something other than Christ and his values? So that's pretty much where I land on that one.
Yeah, and I remember over the summer, Bill de Blasio, obviously the mayor of New York City, when all the rioting was happening in New York, his message was kind of, well, we just got to hunker down and let it happen and get through it.
Right.
So if it's wrong today, which it is, you know, what happened at the Capitol is wrong, and I think everybody's on the same page about that, then it was wrong all summer too, and we just need to get to a better place. Collectively, you know, it's bad no matter what your political affiliation is to be violent and to storm buildings and to ransack businesses or the Capitol. Like, all of that is wrong, and we need to put a stop to it.
Right. Yeah. And that's where the frustration lies, I think, is the hypocrisy. I mean, I had somebody tweet at me that when I basically condemned the riots that had happened, they said, I didn't see much violence there. And I don't know how you look at the scenes that were playing out. As a massive mob is overrunning the police, I don't see how that's very much different than what we saw over the summer. Very, very similar. So you got to be able to just step outside the political box and condemn wrong actions when we see them. Otherwise, as we talked about earlier this week, you lose the high ground and you really have no room to argue that position. So speaking of having no room to argue a position, looks like President Trump may not have much room on social media to making arguments any longer if this keeps up.
Yeah, so story number two is Facebook founder and CEO Mark Zuckerberg announced this week that he has banned President Trump from posting on his site indefinitely, but at least until Inauguration Day on January 20th. So Zuckerberg said in a Facebook post of his own, "We believe the risks of allowing the president to continue to use our service during this period of time is simply too great. Therefore, we are extending the block we have placed on his Facebook and Instagram accounts indefinitely." The decision to block Trump's access to Facebook comes after, obviously, the pro-Trump rioters broke into the Capitol and ended up reaching both chambers of Congress, as we've talked about, when the vice president and all of Congress was there.
Yeah.
So several argued that he was inciting violence, that the president was inciting violence, and that's what led to what happened in D.C. So that's kind of the impetus for the ban on Facebook, and also a temporary ban on Twitter that's since been removed. But Twitter over the winter holiday, is worth saying, over Christmas, they temporarily locked the president's account this week. But over the Christmas holiday, they said that the protections that apply to world leaders might be removed after Trump leaves office. So right now they leave some of his posts up because he's a world leader and there's a public interest in leaving that information up. But they're saying that they might start censoring him more, might even ban him altogether once he is removed from office or once he leaves office, because he won't have those protections anymore as a world leader, right?
Yeah.
So that's a possibility, and is something that the Twitter team has warned about as a possibility. So what's the left saying with all of this? The left is saying that the bans on social media are correct, they're appropriate, that Trump is a threat, that he needs to be removed from office, and that he at least needs to be removed from social media, because what he's saying does incite violence. Even this morning, Senator Joe Manchin tweeted that at Twitter CEO Jack Dorsey, asking him for him to be suspended because what he's posting is dangerous and it's critical for the preservation of our democracy for him to be removed. Now, it is worth noting that last night, Dan, on Thursday, Trump posted another video clearly condemning the violence. He said that he is committed to a peaceful transition of power. So Trump said, "To those who engaged in acts of violence and destruction, you do not represent our country. And to those who broke the law, you will pay. Now Congress has certified the results of the election. A new administration will be inaugurated on January 20th. My focus now turns to ensuring a smooth, orderly, and seamless transition of power. This moment calls for healing and reconciliation." Trump went on to say, "Defeating this pandemic and rebuilding the greatest economy on earth will require us to work together. It will require a renewed emphasis on the civic values of patriotism, faith, charity, community, and family." So what's the right saying? Obviously, conservatives see any sort of censorship as a free speech violation. Countless hearings with Facebook and Twitter on Capitol Hill have debated whether these are platforms or if they're publishers. Because if they're platforms, obviously, then free speech laws should apply to them. If they're publishers, then that's a different story, and they can determine what they want to publish and what they don't want to publish. But a lot of conservatives actually are wondering now, Dan, if Zuckerberg, who's been kind of against any sort of censorship on Facebook, is changing his tone because he knows that we're about to have a fully Democratic-led government.
Yeah,
get into their good graces.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the danger kind of goes away maybe for him.
I think that's some of the concerns. So why does it matter? It matters because the truth is, regardless of who tweets or how they tweet or what they say, Trump is the president of the United States. Biden will be president of the United States. What both of those men say matters, and people need to be able to engage with what they say, to see what they're saying. We should be able to make our own intellectual decisions is kind of where I fall on that. We're adults, we're big boys and girls. I should be able to look at what the president says, have access to what the president says, and make my own decisions about that information. I don't necessarily want a platform determining what information I should and shouldn't see. And they are private companies and they have the right to do what they're doing, but they are kind of vehicles for free speech right now. They're essentially the public square in the internet age.
Yeah. And I think the whole, they're private companies, technically true, but I think they've grown to the point now where they control a lot of our communication and how people get information. So I think while I'm not in favor of some big government like regulating them, I do think it's incumbent upon them to actually consider their position. And I think that's why they're making these decisions, which I think it's the wrong reaction, but I think at least they understand, okay, right. Yeah, most of the country sees information through one of us, through Facebook, through Twitter, through Google. That's where information is coming from. They're not tuning in to the evening news at night, which is, you know, fake news half the time anyway. But I agree with you, Trey. I think this is a very dangerous precedent to set. These information gatekeepers, when they start dabbling in, well, this information could cause harm, and I don't like this information. Now, they're taking the lowest hanging fruit, right? Trump continually saying that the election was stolen with guaranteed conviction is easy low-hanging fruit for them,
yeah,
to justify, you know, a quote-unquote ban. Similarly to, but what this is what I was thinking about it, Trey. Imagine if, for a second here, let's just hypothetically say, okay, let's say someone has figured out how to actually systematically rig an election, and so many people were in on it, you know, deep state, they decided they wanted to be in on it. And so you had all these electors coming back. Nope, these are official results. They're good. And then they're saying, nope, this is good. And then someone says, whoa, a whistleblower comes out and says, wait a minute here. Here's some evidence. I've got all this stuff. And they're like, no, that's been discredited. Now these big tech they've set the precedent now where you can't listen to any of that stuff. You know, whether or not you believe the election is stolen, you should hear it. You should be able to hear it out and say, okay, let's take a look. Let's see the evidence. Let's go for it. Now, you know, Trump's claims didn't make it through court. They kind of backed off on a lot of them. And so it never got that far. But let's say, for argument's sake, it actually happened. These big tech companies are setting themselves up to basically delete those people because, well, it's not what everyone's saying.
Yeah.
It's not a good precedent.
Well, I think the reality is that in 2020, 2021, like these platforms have become utilities for access to information, right?
Yeah.
We saw over the election cycle, Twitter, Facebook, whatever, were banning and limiting our access to a New York Post story about Hunter Biden.
Yeah.
And it ended up being a completely legitimate story that after the election, news outlets picked up and were like, oh, well, I guess we should cover this now.
Yeah.
It's like, well, it was legitimately censored during the election, despite the fact that it was a bona fide story.
Right.
And the danger in all of this, like you said, the concern that I have is that these companies, and it's fine, but these companies are being led by predominantly liberal people. So I'm certain that these rules are going to be targeted toward one political affiliation over time.
Yeah. I mean, it really is disturbing. That laptop Biden story is very, because whether the laptop had any information that would have been damaged, I mean, it was clearly an October surprise, et cetera, et cetera. You get it. But that doesn't discount that it actually happened. Now, if media outlets did their investigation and they found that, oh, it was just a guy making it up, the laptop doesn't exist, well, then don't report it. But that didn't happen. I mean, the thing existed. It was real. And you can't just ban a story because you don't like it or you think it's very disturbing trend. And they're totally wading into the activist waters, I think. And as you said, it is clearly not going to lean the conservatives' way. And so I can't get over this, Trey. I'm thinking about Venezuela. Imagine if all the big tech companies in Venezuela, Facebook, et cetera, were like, oh, well, the government's saying that this is certified election results, so we're just going to delete everything that questions that. I mean, it's China-like stuff. It's absurd. They're setting themselves up to be basically state propaganda. But
exactly.
Anyway, all right, so we've got another one here, Trey. Story number three. This is in Nigeria. Why we need to be praying for Christians in Nigeria. Hassan John, a communications director for the Church of Nigeria Anglican Communion, told Family Research Council about the dire situation over the holidays there. He said it's been marked with attacks and destruction of villages and communities in the last 2 weeks. At least 5 villages have been attacked near Chibok, where 276 schoolgirls were abducted in April of 2014. These attacks were hardly even reported in local news. Reports have primarily focused on a pastor who was killed and 2 others who have been abducted by Boko Haram. And according to the Council on Foreign Relations, Nigeria security tracker, Boko Haram killed 7 and kidnapped 5 in Ngozi, Borno on December 22nd. On December 24th, Boko Haram killed 6 and kidnapped 3. And on Christmas Day, Islamic State West Africa executed 11 captives. So this is all just over the Christmas season here. And Hassan added that warnings about travels and security advice sent by security forces added to the anxieties this year in the Christmas season. And then on January 5th, another village also near Chibok was attacked and a church was destroyed. And they're still getting information to the extent of the destruction and if anybody died in that. So still fresh, that attack. And then on top of that, you've got the pandemic bringing on already extra stresses going on to this Christian communities there that are already suffering. And so what is the left saying? What is the right saying? Honestly, Trey, both the left and the right, they really haven't been saying much because this hasn't really been in the news that much. So yeah. I'm just going to jump right into why it matters. And it matters because as Christians, obviously we're supposed to be praying for our fellow brothers and sisters in Christ across the globe, and seeking to show Christ's love to all people who are suffering under oppression. We're blessed to live in America. I mean, yeah, religious freedom is definitely trending in the wrong direction here, I think, at this point. But we're also not having churches violently raided and girls kidnapped out of churches and tortured and taken by terrorist groups. So man, we really got to remember to be adding these people to our prayer list. And if you want to help them, you can go to places like Operation Blessing, Voice of the Martyrs. You can go to their websites and you can donate there, and both great organizations that lend support to all kinds of different Christians persecuted across the globe.
Yeah. And at the end of last year at faithwire.com, we talked to people who have been in other countries and on the ground in the Middle East and African countries who have just been dealing with the persecution that a lot of Christians are facing. And I think it's worth noting that on top of the Islamic terrorist stuff, the Christians being targeted by radicals, they're also being targeted by governments in a lot of these countries too, and the pandemic has just given them more reasons to target those groups. I know in some Middle Eastern countries, Christians are having food withheld from them during the pandemic because they're seen as a minority group. They're not favored by the government. So we need to be praying for these people, particularly as Christians, like you said. These are our brothers and sisters in Christ. And I know there's a lot going on in our country, obviously, that we need to be aware of. But we also need to remember that we're part of a church that's much greater than all of this. And we need to keep those people in our thoughts and prayers.
Absolutely. All right. It is time, Trey, for story four, the 25th Amendment. Are we going to see it? Not going to see it? What are the details? Yeah.
So the family of one of the pro-Trump protesters who tragically died during the riots on the U.S. Capitol earlier this week is actually calling for the 25th Amendment to be invoked. So Roseanne Boylan's family said she either collapsed during the rioting or was trampled by those storming the Capitol when she died Wednesday. Her brother-in-law, Justin Cave, told a local Georgia news outlet, quote, "Tragically, she was there and it cost her life. Our family is grieving on every level of our country and for the families that have lost a loved one or suffered injuries and for our own loss. We appreciate your prayers and ask for everyone to respect our privacy as we mourn her death." So Cave went on to say that Roseanne was a, quote, "very passionate person about her beliefs," claiming Trump's rhetoric ultimately incited a riot that killed 4 of his biggest fans. So if the 25th Amendment were to be invoked, it would require Vice President Mike Pence and the majority of the president's cabinet to deem him unfit to remain in power for the next 2 weeks until Joe Biden obviously is sworn in as president on January 20th. So what's the left saying? Well, Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer, as well as House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, have both called for the invocation of the 25th Amendment. We've seen other lawmakers call for the same, particularly Democrats. But even some conservatives have joined on that call from the left to have Pence replace Trump in the remaining days of the administration for the 25th Amendment, obviously, to be invoked, arguing that Pence would be better suited to complete the transfer of power to Biden Biden's administration. There are some, though, conservatives who have argued that it's a bit more complex than that, and invoking the 25th Amendment could set a dangerous precedent, could cause some chaos right at the end of Trump's term in office. It's worth noting Education Secretary Betsy DeVos and Transportation Secretary Elaine Chao, obviously both conservatives who have served Trump and his administration, have both resigned from the president's cabinet. So why does it matter? All of this matters for the obvious reasons. It's tragic to know that four people and now a Capitol Police officer have needlessly passed away because of what happened Wednesday at the Capitol. The violence on both sides, Dan, just has to stop, like we've talked about for days this week. Across the political spectrum, it's not the way to get things done. It's not how we should operate. And I think Democrats, Republicans, you know, anywhere in between, we should all be able to come together and condemn that. And we've got to choose for all of us a better, more peaceful path going forward. And I just hope that that's what happens in the days and weeks to come in this next administration.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we only have 2 weeks to go. So, you know, you think maybe a lot of this is going to be political and just they want to get that, you know, that's my first reaction when I see it, is it's, you know, the left wants to get it on record that they were able to impeach him. And so they can say that as a talking point looking back. So, you know, whatever's in the best interest of the country here in the next 2 weeks, as even Trump was saying that he's going to commit to a peaceful transition of power, should probably be where we're focused at this point and not on partisan politics. All right, Trey, that's all the time we have for today. Thanks, as always, for being here, and thank you for listening. And as always, for more news from a distinctly Christian perspective, make faithwire.com, cbnnews.com, both of them a daily visit on your internet browsings. God bless you. We will see you on Monday. Have a great weekend, and we'll see you then.